Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alhamdulillah, alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen, wa salatu wa salamu ala sayyidil anbiya'i wal mursaleen, wa ala alihi wa ashabi ajma'in, amma ba'd, fa'udhu billahi min ash-shaytanir rajim, bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Wa laqad nasarakumullahu bi badri wa antum adillah, fattaqullaha la'allakum tashkurun. صدق الله العلي العظيم وصدق رسوله النبي الأمين الكريم. Respected audience, yesterday we heard about the setting of the Battle of Badr, which was about 80 miles outside Medina Munawwara. And as I have already mentioned before, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after disallowing the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Sahaba Ikram from any violence, any physical battle, any retaliation, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had now given permission for defense, and the Muslims were now permitted, the Sahaba Ikram were now permitted to defend themselves, and therefore this battle and the early battles in Islam were all defensive. And as you can see, as I have mentioned many a times before, that an offensive battle does not happen on the doorstep of your home. And 80 miles away from home is just outside Medina Munawwara. It is not far from Medina Munawwara. And it is clear from the books that the people of Mecca, they had left in order to fight physically in battle. And the Sahaba Ikram with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had left Medina Munawwara with no intention of fighting. And the Sahaba Ikram were fasting in the month of Ramadan, and they didn't have much food, they didn't have the provisions, yet they were there in order to defend themselves because of the threat that they had against the Muslims and the Medina Munawwara and the women and children, etc. Now, the Muslims were about less than 313 physically present in the Battle of Badr, while the non-Muslims were about 1,000, and some narrations say they were 950 of them that were there for fighting. 70 camels the Muslims had, and the non-Muslims had 700 camels, and the Muslims only had 3 horses, and the non-Muslims had 100 horses. And in terms of swords, weaponry, the Muslims only had 8, and the non-Muslims had 950, yani every individual had a sword. And similarly, armor, 950 people, every one of them had armor with them from the Quraysh of Mecca. Whereas the Muslims, they only had 6 in terms of armor, 6 suits of armor, and only 8 swords and 3 horses and 70 camels. And 313, or less than 313 Sahaba Ikram. And this was the situation in which the Muslims had to fight in the Battle of Badr. Now, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, without doubt, is sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was given ikhtiyarat, yani he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was given special powers by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whereby the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would be able to provide the Sahaba Ikram with that which they did not have. For example, there were 2 brothers who were riding on one of the camels from amongst the Sahaba Ikram from Medina Munawwara, and the camel became unwell and sickly, and unfortunately they knew that now we will not be able to continue on this camel. So one of the brothers, he made intention, and it was the one who was the owner of the camel, he made intention that, Ya Allah, if my camel gets better and I am able to ride on it and fight in the Battle of Badr alongside the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, your messenger, your beloved, then I will sacrifice this camel upon my return to Medina, and I will distribute the meat to the poor. When he made that intention and he said it with his tongue to his other brother, at that moment the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam appeared, and he sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked for some water. He performed ablution, and then the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked him to open the mouth of the camel, and then the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam placed some leftover water in the mouth of the camel and then sprinkled some on the back and on the body of the camel, and immediately the camel became well. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to him that, ride on it, the camel is better than before. And he rode the camel, both the brothers rode the camel, and they fought in the battle of Badr. And upon their return to Medina Munawwara, after gaining victory, they sacrificed the animal and distributed the meat to the poor. Similarly, at one point, one of the Sahaba-i-Kiram's sword was broken, snapped into two. And as we've already heard, that there was only a few swords. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave him a piece of wood and said to him that, take this. And as soon as he took it, it became a sword and it did the work of a sword. And many things like this happened. But in the battle of Badr, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in the night, as I mentioned yesterday, that the Sahaba-i-Kiram, they all rested. They were all sleeping. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam stayed awake. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he stayed awake whilst all the other Sahaba-i-Kiram rested that night. And this was the Thursday night, which was the night of Friday. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, he stayed awake whilst the Sahaba-i-Kiram, there are narrations that the Sahaba-i-Kiram said that sleep overcame us. We became so tired that we could not control our own sleep. We were falling asleep as though Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had placed tiredness upon us so that we could completely rest throughout the night peacefully, and we all slept peacefully. And there are Sahaba-i-Kiram who said that when I tried to keep myself awake, I still couldn't, and I'd just fall asleep. And some of them tried to stay sitting up without leaning on anything, and they fell flat and they fell asleep as well. So the Sahaba-i-Kiram, they were resting in the night, besides a few which the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had appointed for certain duties. And amongst them, Sayyiduna Abdullah ibn Mas'ud is one of them, and the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam sent them near the Kuffar of Quraysh to see their activities, and they came back and they said, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, they cannot even sleep. They are all awake and they are in fear. They are overwhelmed, and any bit of sound in the night that they hear, they become all worried and they all sit up, and what's happened? So none of them can sleep and they are in fear, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. Now the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, before the war began in Makkah Mukarramah, there was a few young men who were yet to come and join the battlefield of Badr in favor of the enemies of Islam. But before they left from Makkah Mukarramah, they heard a loud sound from the unseen. They didn't see who made that sound. They had never heard that voice before. But the voice said to them that the people of Makkah have lost the battle. They have failed and they have been defeated and they have had to flee from the battle of Badr. And these people thought that the battle has finished and we were supposed to attend. But upon hearing that sound, they decided not to move forward and they remained in Makkah Mukarramah. They did not join the non-Muslims. And this was from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then the battle began, and the way the battle began was at the beginning, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he lined up all the Sahaba-i-Kiram, and the Kuffar were lined up on the other side, and the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had a knife in his hand. That is all he sallallahu alaihi wasallam had. And with that knife, he sallallahu alaihi wasallam was walking with that knife, and he was making sure that the Sahaba-i-Kiram were all standing in a saf, in a straight line. And one of the Sahaba-i-Kiram, Sayyiduna Sawad Ansari radiallahu ta'ala, he was slightly out, yani his stomach was still slightly out of line. So the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam slightly poked him and said to him that, move back and move in line. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Istavi ya Sawad. And he came out and he said, Ya Rasulullah, you have struck me with a knife, or you have poked a knife in my stomach. I want qisas. I want revenge for that, Ya Rasulullah. I am rightful to for you to compensate for it, that you need to compensate for this act that you have done. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam immediately lifted the material, the clothing that was covering his stomach, and he said, "Here, Ya Sawad, here's the knife. Take your compensation." And he immediately ran to the stomach of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and kissed it. And he said, "Ya Rasulullah, I am about to go in the battlefield and I do not know if I am going to live or not, Ya Rasulullah. I thought how I wish I could touch the body of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, so that at least if I die, I die and go to Jannah and I am protected from the fire of hell by touching your body." And then he embraced the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the Sahaba Kiram, in this manner, they were all ready and they had complete faith in the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam then gave a lecture to the Sahaba Kiram. He gave a lecture and he told them about the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the fact that Jannat is awaiting those who give their life in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the dangers that the Muslims are to pose in the case that the people of Mecca do not leave and leave the Muslims alone. And upon hearing all of that, the Sahaba Kiram were all ready, and the Messenger of Allah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam thereafter came to the tent that was made for him, and he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was to remain there, and he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also was in the battlefield, and when he was not in the battlefield, that is where he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would be. And the enemy, in accordance to the Kuffar of Quraysh, is the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that is who they wanted to attack. And to stand side by side with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was the most fearful and dangerous thing in the Battle of Badr. And when it came to the time of who will stand with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and stand side by side with him, then Sayyiduna Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala was the first to come forward and say, "I will stay with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam." And he stayed with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam throughout the battle. And people like Sayyiduna Hamza radiallahu ta'ala, Sayyiduna Sa'd ibn Mu'adh radiallahu ta'ala, they were all also taking when they had the opportunity to protect the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they got there and they protected the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But then they had to attend other duties that were given to them by the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There is a narration regarding Sayyiduna Ali radiallahu ta'ala in which he asks his companions later on, after the life of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in the time of the Aimmah Tabi'een, he says that, "Do you know who the most brave amongst us, yani amongst the companions of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, was?" And everyone thought it was Sayyiduna Ali, because Sayyiduna Ali is one of the most brave companions of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Without doubt, he is the lion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Sayyiduna Ali radiallahu ta'ala replied, "No, you are incorrect. Kana Abu Bakr, Sayyiduna Abu Bakr is Ashja'ana. He is the most brave amongst us." And the reason why he gave is because in the Battle of Badr, it was he who stood around the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who defended the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam from his right, from his left, from in front of him and from behind him. And that was the role that Sayyiduna Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala played throughout the Battle of Badr. Now, the Battle of Badr, in the Battle of Badr, the Amir bin al-Hadrami was the one whose brother had been killed when Sayyiduna Abdullah ibn Juhush went with that letter which he was to open 2 days later. And when he opened it, he was advised to travel to a place called Nakhla between Taif and Makkah Mukarrama and keep an eye on the activities of the Quraysh. And when they were exposed, they had to make a decision whether to let them leave or fight them to prevent them from letting the people of Makkah know and knowing about them. So they fought, and one of the people that died, he was Amr ibn Hadrami. And Amr ibn Hadrami's brother, Amir ibn Hadrami, was the one who came in the Battle of Badr to take revenge for his brother. And this was the justification for Abu Jahl. He used this to say, "This is the reason why we have to go for the Battle of Badr, to take revenge for Amr ibn Hadrami." So Amir ibn Hadrami was the first to come out, and he asked for someone to come out and fight him. And Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala's slave, Mahja, he radiallahu ta'ala, he had accepted Islam. He went into the battlefield, and that was the first war, the first battle that occurred. And Sayyiduna Haritha ibn Suraqa Ansari radiallahu ta'ala was drinking some water from a well, or from a pool of water that was there, and one of the kuffar of Quraysh, they attacked him in that manner whilst he was drinking water. He didn't even have a weapon with him. As for the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had already forbidden the Sahaba-i-Kiram from harming anyone that was not fighting them. He sallallahu alaihi wasallam had up to the extent mentioned a few names of the kuffar of Makkah Mukarramah, of Quraysh, and said that these people have not come to fight us. They have been forced by Abu Jahl. They do not want to fight us. They are not our enemies, but Abu Jahl has forced them to come out, and that's why they are here. So them people are not to be touched. This was the manner in which the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had prepared the Sahaba-i-Kiram. And this is what the Sahaba-i-Kiram did. They were merciful. They only fought against he who was fighting against them. As for those who were the enemies of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they were advised, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam advised the Sahaba-i-Kiram that if they dropped their weapon, then they were to be taken as captives and not be killed, except for certain ones amongst them. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had ordered for them that they be killed wherever they are found. فَقْتُلُوهُمْ حَيْثُ ثَقِفْتُمُهُمْ, because they were such enemies of Islam that they had caused trouble to the Muslims since the beginning and even now, and they were the cause of the Battle of Badr, like Abu Jahl, these people. So these people had absolutely no right to remain alive, according to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and what the Sahaba-i-Kiram, because of the tortures of the Sahaba-i-Kiram and the Battle of Badr happening and all these things that happened, they should not have happened at all. Now, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he advises the Sahaba-i-Kiram to remain, I apologize, can we all just recite Durood Sharif once? Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina wa Nabiyyina wa Mawlana Muhammadin ma'adin al-judi wal-karam wa manba'i al-ilmi wal-hilmi wal-hikam wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa barik wa sallim. When the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, had all the Muslims were prepared for battle and the non-Muslims were also prepared for battle, the first people after the Amir ibn Hadrami that I just mentioned, the first people from amongst the Quraysh that came out was Utbah ibn Rabi'a, one of the worst enemies of Islam. Utbah ibn Rabi'a came out into the battlefield with his brother Shaybah ibn Rabi'a and his son Walid ibn Utbah. So Utbah came with his son and his brother, and he came out into the battlefield, and the battle was now about to begin. And he shouted at the top of his voice that send someone who is a match to us to come and fight against us. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, he ordered Sayyiduna Auf and Sayyiduna Mu'adh and Sayyiduna Abdullah ibn Rawaha radiallahu ta'ala anhum that you go and fight against them. Now Sayyiduna Auf and Sayyiduna Mu'adh and Sayyiduna Abdullah radiallahu ta'ala, and they come into the battlefield, and Utbah asks them that, who are you? I don't know who you are. And they tell them that this is who we are. And they were from amongst the Ansar. So Utbah said that you leave the battlefield. We have nothing against you people. You lot leave the battlefield and send someone who is a match to us. Yani they wanted someone from the Quraysh of Makkah. So then the Messenger of Allah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam said, Ya Hamza, O Hamza, the uncle of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, one of the lions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. O Hamza, you, O Ali, Sayyidina Ali al-Murtada, Karramallahu ta'ala wajhul kareem, And Sayyiduna Ubaidah radiallahu ta'ala, and these three, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ordered them that you three go. So then Sayyiduna Hamza, Sayyiduna Ali, and Sayyiduna Ubaidah radiallahu ta'ala, and Huma Ajma'een, they come in front of Utbah, his brother, and his brother Shaybah, and his son Walid. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam observed that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was observing all of this, and Utbah said to them that, "Who are you?" And Sayyiduna Hamza radiallahu ta'ala came closer, and they realized that this is Hamza, and he said, "I am Hamza, and this is Ali, and this is Ubaidah radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'een." So Sayyiduna Hamza radiallahu ta'ala was the first who fought against Utbah, and Sayyiduna Hamza radiallahu ta'ala was known as a great warrior. And Sayyiduna Hamza radiallahu ta'ala, and he defeated Utbah, he killed Utbah. Sayyiduna Ali Murtaza karramallahu ta'ala wajhul kareem, he killed Walid. And then Sayyiduna Ubaidah radiallahu ta'ala, he sat down tired because he had a wound on his body because Shaybah had harmed him. So Sayyiduna Ali radiallahu ta'ala immediately jumped onto Shaybah, and Sayyidina Ali radiallahu ta'ala finished him off. And after that, the whole battlefield started to begin. And Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, in the hadith, it says, and not only in the hadith, in the Quran, it clearly says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent 1,000 malaika to the battlefield, to fight in the battle of Badr. And after that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent another 2,000 and made it into 3,000. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent another 2,000, and altogether 5,000 malaika took part in that battlefield. And the narration says that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, on his right hand side, the malaika came with a big army of the malaika. On his left hand side, there was a big huge army of the malaika that were there. Sayyiduna Israfil alayhi salam was there, Sayyiduna Israel alayhi salam was there, Sayyiduna Mikael alayhi salam was there, Sayyiduna Jibrail alayhi salam was there. Sayyiduna Israfil alayhi salam, there is a narration which mentions that even Sayyiduna Israfil alayhi salam, who was there blowing, who was all the time with the horn in his mouth to blow the horn for the beginning of Qiyamah, at that time, according to a weak narration, that even he left and he came and fought in the battle of Badr. It was being announced in the heavens and in the skies that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Habib of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is about to go into war. Go and support the Habib of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the malaika, they came into the battlefield. And there are narrations about certain individuals who were observing the war from the hilltops, who said that there's a narration of one who says that I was with my brother, or with my cousin, the son of my uncle. I was on the hilltop and observing the battle, and I thought to myself that when the war begins, I will see who is winning, and whoever is winning, I will go and join them. We will go and join them, and we will go and join them so that we can take part in the booty of war. So he says that I hadn't accepted Islam yet. But he says that whilst me and my cousin were observing before the war began, suddenly I felt a wind, and then suddenly I heard a sound saying, "O Khayrum, move forward." And Khayrum is the name of the horse of Sayyiduna Jibreel alayhi salam. So Sayyiduna Jibreel alayhi salam came on his horse and with an army of malaika and all these malaika. So there is more than 5,000 malaika there and the Sahaba ikram. How on earth do you think the kuffar of Makkah were to beat the Muslims? There was absolutely no chance for the kuffar of Makkah. They had absolutely no chance at all. Sayyiduna Bilal radiallahu ta'ala in the battlefield was looking for Umayyah, the one who tortured him. Sayyiduna Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam had permitted after Utbah and Shaybah and Walid were killed by Sayyiduna Hamza and Sayyiduna Ali radiallahu ta'ala, after that the son of Sa'id ibn al-As, whose name was Ubaid, he came out into the battlefield, and he was completely clothed in armor, There was nothing visible from his body besides his two eyes. And he came out in the battlefield and he started shouting that send someone to fight against me. I am the father of warriors, and I am the father of being tough, and I will fight whoever you send. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to Sayyidina Zubair ibn al-Awam that you go. Sayyidina Zubair radiallahu ta'ala went into the battlefield and he saw that, how can I harm this individual who is, he's completely laced in armor. There is no way I can strike him where he would be harmed. And Sayyidina Zubair radiallahu ta'ala all said that all I could see was the two eyes, the holes for his eyes in the metal that he was wearing. So he says that I went into the battlefield, I had no sword, I had a spear. So I went running with that spear and I targeted his eyes and I threw the spear, and the spear went right through his eye hole and killed him. And he died in that manner. And the messenger, and then the war began, and the Sahaba Kiram went into the battlefield, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam went into the battlefield, and the Kuffar started joining, they all ran into the battlefield. And Sayyidina Abdul Rahman ibn Auf radiallahu ta'ala, and he says that whilst I was there in the battlefield, suddenly a young boy came on my right hand side or left hand side, one of the sides, and he started asking me that, oh uncle, who is Abu Jahl? Show me who Abu Jahl is. So he said that he couldn't see Abu Jahl at that time. So he said, what are you going to do with Abu Jahl? And both of them had a sword. When swords were so limited, both of these children had a sword. And he said that, oh uncle, I am going to, when I find him, I have taken oath with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that I will kill him. So then he says that, and then on the other side, another child came and he looked exactly the same as him. And he said the same things, that show me Abu Jahl. And they both were brothers. One of them was named Mu'awidh and the other was Mu'adh. And both of them had taken oath that they will kill Abu Jahl because he disrespects and he is the enemy of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that he is the Fir'aun of this time. And Abu Jahl is the worst enemy of the Muslims. And these two children wanted to just take revenge and get rid of him and prevent his actions from harming the Muslims. So Abdul Rahman ibn Auf radiallahu ta'ala says that at that point I saw Abu Jahl, he appeared, and I said to them, I pointed to him and I said, that is Abu Jahl. As soon as I said that, these both of them competing against each other, they jumped like tigers, like lions, how they like a fierce animal, and they went and they completely fallen, and he was about to die. And Abu Jahl was wounded all over his body. After the war had finished, there is a narration in which it says that Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala an, he was walking in the Battle of Badr, the aftermath of the Battle of Badr, and he saw Abu Jahl's body, and he went and he grabbed his beard and he said, Anta Abu Jahl, and he was still alive at that time. So Abu Jahl tried to move his head forward. He was completely full of wounds, and he couldn't move, he couldn't get up. And he said, yes, I am Abu Jahl. So Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala and then smiled that the enemy of Islam has been killed in this battle. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had named him the Fir'aun of this ummah. So then Abu Jahl started saying, he was still arrogant. He was still so arrogant about the way he was. And this was unfortunately the state of Abu Jahl, who people used to call Abu al-Hakam, the father of wisdom. He, after the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam's announcement of prophethood and his rejection of that true message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he became known as Abu Jahl. Sayyiduna Bilal radiallahu ta'ala was specifically looking for Umayyah, because Umayyah was the one that he had tortured him so much. And Sayyiduna Sa'd radiallahu ta'ala, who went to Medina Munawwara before this battle happened, and already warned Umayyah that if you leave, when these people will take you out of Makkah, the Muslims will kill you. So Umayyah was really scared himself, and he was fully laced in armor. And there were places that were open on the sides and places like that. So Sayyiduna Bilal radiallahu ta'ala was throughout the Battle of Badr just looking for Umayyah, that I want to make sure that I will attack him and I will kill him. So Sayyiduna Sa'd radiallahu ta'ala, like he was the Khalifa of Umayyah, so was Sayyiduna Abdul Rahman ibn Auf. So Abdul Rahman ibn Auf was also a Khalif, yani they had an agreement with, he had an agreement with Umayyah, and the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had not yet forbidden these type of agreements. So Umayyah saw that Sayyiduna Bilal radiallahu ta'ala has seen him, and Sayyiduna Bilal started shouting to the Sahaba Ikram that there is Umayyah, here he is, attack him, kill him, he is the one who tortured me all my life in Makkah Mukarrama, until Sayyiduna Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala bought me and saved me and freed me. So the Sahaba Ikram then ran to attack Umayyah, and Sayyiduna Abdul Rahman ibn Auf then said to Umayyah that I will not be able to protect you with so many coming to attack you. Therefore, lie down on the floor and I will lie on top of you so that they cannot attack you, and I will protect you. They will not attack me. So then Umayyah lies down on the floor. Sayyiduna Abdul Rahman ibn Auf radiallahu ta'ala, and he lies down above him in order to protect him. But so the Sahaba Ikram, they stop attacking because they see Abdul Rahman ibn Auf is protecting him. But Sayyiduna Bilal radiallahu ta'ala got a spear from someone, and he lied down, and from the sides, because Umayyah was a very fat man, and he was wide and fat, and his stomach and his sides of the body was still popping out. Sayyiduna Abdul Rahman ibn Auf couldn't cover it all. So Sayyiduna Bilal radiallahu ta'ala lied down and started poking Umayyah with the spear, and poked him so much that Umayyah dropped with that, and Umayyah was finished because of that. So all these things were happening, and at the same time the Malaika were in that battlefield. And there are so many narrations where the Sahaba Ikram came in the court of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and said, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wasallam, I was chasing my opponent, and suddenly before he reached the strike of my sword, suddenly I saw that his head fell off his body, and someone already struck him. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would say to him that this was one of the Malaika that came into the battle of Badr. And these things happened frequently, many narrations regarding this, that a Sahabi was saying that I had three come to attack me, and suddenly all three of the heads fell off their bodies and they died, and some fell off their horses, and someone's horse was struck and the horse was killed, and all these type of things happened in the battle of Badr, where the Sahaba Ikram witnessed the unseen fighting with them, and that they were supported by the unseen. Even when they were under attack, the enemies were falling because the Malaika were there in order to support them. And subhanallah, this was the great battle of Badr, and it is known as the greatest battle of Islam, because the Muslims at that point were not only defending themselves, but they were proving a point to the rest of the Arab world and those around them, that the Muslims are not weak. They have the support of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they are protected by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the Malaika come and support them. In the battlefield, one of the Sahaba Ikram, his eye fell out. His eye had fallen out of the socket of the eye, where the eye is placed, and it was hanging down because it was still attached. And the Sahaba Ikram advised him that cut it off, and he said, no, first I will speak to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he comes to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam takes the eye with his blessed hand. And in one narration it also mentions that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam placed some of his saliva onto it, and he placed it back into his eye, and his eye became absolutely normal. And these type of karamat happened throughout the battlefield, like the, and this was Sayyiduna Qatada radiallahu ta'ala, whose blessed eye had become wounded. And when the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam placed it back into his socket, into the socket, the Sahaba Ikram would say that we can't differentiate which one was wounded and which one was not. So it became completely cured. Similarly, the sword of Sayyiduna Uqasha radiallahu ta'ala, which I mentioned, that his sword split into two, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave Sayyiduna Uqasha a piece of wood, or a twig, or a branch of wood, and he took that, a stick, and with that he did the work of a sword. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would receive Sahaba Ikram who would come and say that, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, I suddenly felt a huge gust of wind go past me. And these were the malaika that were coming into the battle of Badr, and they were fighting alongside the Muslims. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had also said that the malaika and some of the Sahaba kiram even saw the malaika. They even saw the turbans of the malaika. There are narrations that they were wearing yellow imama. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also said that these amaim that they are wearing, the imama that they are wearing, the Sahaba, the Malaika, it is the imama differentiates between the Muslims and the non-believers. That is the imama that we wear. And that's the imama that the Malaika wore. And some of the Sahaba kiram saw these Malaika. They saw some very white and bright faces full of light. And there are narrations where the Sahaba kiram brought captives back to the Prophet ﷺ that, Ya Rasulullah, I have captured such and such. And sometimes there's a narration where a Sahabi who was really short, he brought a captive that was really tall. And he said, the Messenger of Allah ﷺ said that, how did you capture such a tall man when you are so short? And he said, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, what happened was that he was my opponent, and then suddenly he was tied and he was fallen on the floor as a captive, so I just took him with me. There are some narrations where it says that a man appeared, a really tall man who was full of brightness in his face. He was white and bright, and he had an imama on his head, and he was a person who gave a lot of awe to those who were present. And he appeared and he captured this person and he gave him to me to bring to you, Ya Rasulullah. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would say that was one from amongst the malaika. So this was the situation of the Battle of Badr, and many people became captives in the Battle of Badr. And after the Battle of Badr finished, the non-Muslims, they were fleeing the battlefield. And when they fled the battlefield, the women remained. So the men were running away, but the women were not running away. And that was the situation of the battlefield of Badr. So it was a great victory for the Muslims. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam stayed in the field of Badr for another 3 days. And after the 3 days, the narration mentioned in Sahih Ahadith in Bukhari Muslim, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam went to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had ordered for the deceased bodies of the non-Muslims to be thrown into a well. In one narration, it mentions a well, that they were thrown into a well, and in one narration, it says that a hole was dug in the ground or a big massive hole in the ground, and they were thrown into that. And after the 3 days, when they were about to leave, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam went off on his own, and the Sahaba kiram followed. Amongst them was Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam went to the bodies of the non-Muslims, and he sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to them, Ki ya Aba Jahal, Ya Umayya, Ya Fala bin Fala, O such and such, the son of such and such, Hal wajadtum ma wa'adakumullahu wa rasuluh? Have you found what Allah and the Messenger and His Messenger had promised you? Haqqan, as true? So Allah and the Messenger had promised them that they will be defeated. But the hadith, the narration that I remember says that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Ke hal wajadtum ma wa'ada rabbukum, your Rabb, yani your idols had promised you. Did you receive that victory that your idols had promised you? And then the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would say, فَإِنِّي قَدْ وَجَدْتُ مَا وَعَدَنِيَ اللَّهُ حَقًّا, that I have definitely found that what Allah promised me, I have received. Allah promised me victory, I have received victory. And your idols, you Abu Jahl, said to the people that your idols have promised you victory. Have you received that victory? So Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala said, Ya Rasulullah, kayfa takallama atsadul arwah? How can you speak to those bodies who do not have have a ruh in them. La ruha fi. That's it. He says, كيف تكلم أجسادا لا روح فيها. That there is no ruh in the bodies. How can you speak to them? The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, ما أنتم بأسماء لما أقول منهم غير أنهم لا يستطيعون أن يردوا على شيء علي شيء. That you cannot hear more of that which I am saying than them. The difference is that they do not have the power to reply to me, whereas you have the power to reply to me. And through this, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam spoke to the non-believers, the bodies of the non-believers who were deceased. And from this, the ulama-i kiram have disputed the matter, and Ala Hazrat Imam Ahmad Raza radiallahu ta'ala and many other ulama-i kiram have said that this clearly proves that even the dead listen, they can hear. And that is why the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is also reported to have said, يَسْمَعُونَ كَمَا تَسْمَعُونَ وَلَكِنْ لَا يُجِيبُونَ. That they listen in the same way as you listen, however, they do not reply. And there is another narration in which the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, وَالَّذِي نَفْسِي بِيَدِهِ. I swear by He in whose hands is my life. Yani, I swear by Allah. مَا أَنْتُمْ بِأَسْمَعَ لِمَا أَقُولُ مِنْهُمْ. وَلَكِنْ لَا يَقْدِرُونَ أَنْ يُجِيبُوا. I swear by Allah that you do not hear more than what they can hear from what I say. But they do not have the strength to reply to me. Yani, they can't speak so that we can hear a voice from them. But the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is known in his mu'jizat, where he has actually spoke to the deceased, and he has spoke to animals and whatnot, and who not. Anyhow, the malaika, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself said, "Inna Allaha maddani yawma badrin wa hunainin bi malaikata." That indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala helped me with the malaika in the battle of Badr and in the battle of Hunayn. And the truth is, even in the battle of Uhud, the malaika had supported the Muslims throughout. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam received victory because of the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, amongst the captives, there was Sayyiduna Abbas radiallahu ta'ala an. And Sayyiduna Abbas radiallahu ta'ala an, when all the captives came to Medina Munawwara, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had said to the Sahaba ikram that, what do we do with the captives? And Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala advised that, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wasallam, I believe we should have all of them killed. But Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala then stood up and said, Ya Rasulullah, I advise that we place a ransom upon the captives, and their relatives will have to come and pay that fee, and if they pay that fee, then they can take them and we will free them, because we are at the moment in a situation where we are in need of wealth, and therefore this will be the best solution for us. So this ransom fee was fixed for the individuals, and the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam took them all back to Medina. In Medina Munawwara, the news had reached that the Muslims have been victorious. Allah has given them victory, and it was an absolute shock that the Muslims defeated the Quraysh of Mecca, because they were known for their strength in battle, and being in a huge number in comparison to the Muslims, they failed. And this news had spread throughout the Arab world and also in the outskirts of the Arab world. Now, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had already said that do not tie the captives so tight that it makes it difficult for them, and be easy on the captives, and make sure you feed them and give them drink. And all the mercy of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was apparent and exposed to the people, how merciful he sallallahu alaihi wasallam was. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had also said regarding those who had no ransom, who had no one to give to those who were not capable of providing any ransom from their families, that any one of them who can teach how to read and write, if they teach 10 children from amongst the people, from amongst the Muslims, how to read and write, then they will be freed. Because and in this manner, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam showed the importance of education and how education is a lot more important than wealth. If you teach the children of Medina how to read and write, then you will be freed. And anyhow, Sayyidina Abbas radiallahu ta'ala, and he had some gold on him that he came with, a lot of gold. And the gold, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam took it away from him. And Sayyidina Abbas radiallahu ta'ala an, he said to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam that, Ya Muhammad, at that time he had not accepted Islam. So he said that, forgive my ransom because you have taken the gold from me. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that that wealth which was brought in order to support the battle against the Muslims cannot be taken as a ransom fee, and therefore this cannot be used for it. There was no exception. And that gold he had specifically with him was for, because he was one of the hosts, and one of his duties was to for one of the days he had to feed all of the kuffar of Quraysh, the whole army of the non-Muslims. So that's what that gold was for. So the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam already knew that, and Sayyidina Abbas radiallahu ta'ala was amazed that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam knew what that gold was for. So he, and because Sayyidina Abbas radiallahu ta'ala's turn for hosting the army had not yet come, so that was that the gold was saved for that. So the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam took that back and said, you can't use that for ransom because it was brought with you to feed the army of the non-Muslims. So then he said that, then I don't have anything else with me. I do not have any wealth in my ownership to give as my fidya, as my ransom fee. So the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that, what about that money that you left with Ummul Fadl, which you gave to her before you left Makkah Mukarramah for this battle, and you said to her that in case I die in this battle, then you give that to my children. What about that money? And upon hearing that, Sayyidina Abbas radiallahu ta'ala an, he immediately accepted Islam. And he said, Ashhadu annaka Rasulullah, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, wa Ashhadu annaka Rasulullah. And Sayyidina Abbas radiallahu ta'ala and his nephews that were with him, Hazrat Aqil and Hazrat Nawfal radiallahu ta'ala, and all three of them accepted Islam upon the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because Sayyidina Abbas said that, when I gave that money to Ummul Fadl, nobody knew besides me and her. And no one was there, and no one knew of that money that I had. I gave it to her in secrecy. How do you know, Ya Rasulullah? And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that Allah informs me. Tilka amba'ul ghaybi nuhiha ilayk. These are the informations of ghayb that we give to you as wahi, and this was the knowledge of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Similarly, the son-in-law of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Abu al-As ibn al-Rabi', who had not accepted Islam, he was also brought back as a captive, and he was the one that Sayyida Zainab radiallahu ta'ala anha was married to. So Sayyida Zainab radiallahu ta'ala anha, what we'll do is we'll listen to the information about Sayyida Zainab radiallahu ta'ala's husband tomorrow, inshallah, because we have gone over the time that we had prescribed for this subject. Jazakumullahu khair. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.